You to join me this morning. We're going to be in verse 23 and following. And as you're turning to Matthew 22, verses 23 and following, children, it's time to go to kid life with the lambs. Adios, amigos. Y'all have fun. And I was ready to send mine after song one. But we want them to learn how to worship, right? Big church is for kids too, okay? Big church is for kids too. You know, nothing teaches you that worship is not about you than worshiping next to a little one, right? Worship is not about you. It's not about me. It's about our Savior. It's about how good He is to us. Now, last week we took a break from the Gospel of Matthew that we've been traveling through for a long time to look at the empty tomb, the hinge pin of our faith, what our faith turns upon, that Christ, as Trent said earlier, Christ has risen, He has conquered death, He has conquered sin, and now we live in that. We are resurrection Christians. We are those who serve a risen Savior. But today we're flashback in Matthew, the final days of Jesus' life on this earth. And in our text this morning, we run into a religious group who have come to give Jesus the KO blow, right? The KO blow, knockout time. They've got this propped up theoretical scenario they're going to lay before Jesus. And the whole point that they're trying to get across to Jesus is that the resurrection is lame. It's not true. They're trying to refute it. And what Jesus does is He defends the resurrection. And ultimately, in our passage, what we'll see is He silences the Sadducees. Now, today's passage may prove difficult to hear, challenging. Okay, show of hands. Who in this room has ever had the breath knocked out of them? Raise your hand. Breath knocked. Okay. Yeah, you know that point when you're like struggling to get that next breath? It's not a good feeling. It's a little scary. It's a horrible feeling. And the reality is our truth today may make you feel like that. And there's a truth encapsulated in our text that is a bit disheartening, might be discouraging. But here's my hope, that if you would track with me, go on a little journey, have an open heart to the Scriptures, have an open heart to our Savior, which the Scriptures reveal to us, I think you will find at the end of the day this truth to be a good word, maybe even an encouraging word. Okay? So Matthew 22, verse 23 and following, look there with me. It says this: the same day, Sadducees came to Him, that's to Jesus, who say that there is no resurrection. And they asked Him a question, saying, "Teacher, Moses said if a man dies having no children, his brother must marry the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. Now, there were seven brothers among us. The first married and died, and having no offspring, left his wife to his brother. So to the second, and third, down to the seventh. After them all, the woman died." Here's the question: in the resurrection, therefore, of the seven, whose wife will she be? For they all had her. Now, we've met the Sadducees back in Matthew chapter 3 and in Matthew 16. If you remember, the Sadducees were not very popular with the people. They were the priestly class. They had power in the temple, but they were not popular. But they were Bible guys. And specifically, they were the Pentateuch Bible guys. They loved the first five books of the Bible. So I thought we would do a little Bible drill together, right? Kind of like the children have to do. Bible drill. What we're going to do is say the first five books of the Bible together. Are y'all ready? Nod your head if you're ready. Okay. Genesis, Exodus. All right, that's good. I thought we were gonna like trail off a little bit. No, great job. Well done, guys. Pat yourself on the back. I'm just kidding, don't do that. Matthew tells us in verse 23, okay, that the Sadducees, who were Bible guys, who believed in the first five books of the Bible, they didn't believe in the resurrection. In fact, the early church historian Josephus said this: the Sadducees hold that the soul perishes along with the body at death. Right? I've said this before, I'll say it again. The Sadducees were the first YOLOers. You only live once. They believed that. They lived that way. You only live once. And because they believed Moses in the first five books of the Bible didn't say anything about the resurrection, they believed it was an error in doctrine. And it's at this divergent doctrinal stream that they come to test Jesus with their question. All right, look at verse 24. It says, "Teacher, Moses said, if a man dies having no children, his brother must marry the widow and raise up offspring for his brother." Now, the Sadducees were referring to what's known as levirate marriage. Levirate marriage. It was a concept that was taught in the Old Testament, so Deuteronomy chapter 25, and it was also exampled in the Old Testament. Genesis 38, 8 through 10. Anybody know the story of Boaz and Ruth? Okay, that's a story of levirate marriage. Now, levirate is lever in Latin, meaning brother-in-law. And so what levirate marriage taught, what the Bible taught, was the surviving relative, the brother-in-law of the dead husband, would marry his brother's wife. He would impregnate her, right, because she had no children. And then he would raise a family up in his dead brother's name to carry on that family tree. Making sense? He would raise a family up for his sister-in-law, for his brother's name, to carry on the family lineage. Now, I asked a church member about this, you know, what they thought about levirate marriage, and they said this: thank God we live in New Testament times. Unless you're from Arkansas. We have so many reasons to be thankful. So many reasons to be thankful we live in New Testament times, don't we? That Christ has fulfilled the Old Testament, including levirate marriage. Now, the Sadducees, what they do with this is they lay groundwork for this crazy over-the-top scenario that they think will take Jesus down. Look at verses 25 and 26. Okay, so the groundwork's laid. Now, there were seven brothers among us. The first married and died, and having no offspring, left his wife to his brother. Now, that sounds horrible. Okay, just pause for that. Sounds terrible. Like, is she like a piece of property? But really, in that time period, that was a very gracious thing to do. It was a protective thing to do for the woman. So he leaves her to his brother. And then verse 26, it says, so too the second and the third down to the seventh. Now, let me pause for a second. Like, by the time, I'm just think about this for a second. By the time your fourth or fifth brother has died and no children yet, like for me, I'd be like, okay, pause. Hard pass. Like, I think God has other plans for your life, lady. I'm thinking maybe, you know, do you like cross-stitching, online dating? You ever heard of it? I just don't think this is going to work out for us. All my brothers are dying here. I don't want to be a part of this. I'll see you next family reunion. That's what I would be thinking. Verse 27. Here's what happens. After them all, so all the brothers have died, no children. The woman died. And here's the question. In the resurrection, therefore, of the seven, whose wife will she be? For they all had her. Now, in the minds of the Sadducees, it was the unanswerable question. It was of the same species of questions like, can God create a stone so heavy that he can't lift it? Right, have you ever heard that question before? Can God create a stone so heavy he can't lift it? It was that type of question. This question, they believed, put Jesus in dire straits. The legal requirements of the law had been fulfilled in all seven of these marriages. So they were too legit to quit after the resurrection. All of them were good to go. They were biblical marriages. And so there was no way of Jesus answering and saying, well, brother three can have her in the resurrection, or brother five or brother one. Like, Jesus couldn't do that because they were all legit. No one man had the right to her that another man didn't, another brother didn't. And then, you know, Jesus wasn't about to start casting a new show, a sequel to Sister Wives called Brother Husbands. Like, he wasn't going to do that either. Polyandry, right? One wife, multiple husbands. Like, that is outside of God's plan. It was not an option. And so in the minds of the Sadducees, they had Jesus caught. Like, there was no answer to this question. The only option was the resurrection is absurd. Jesus, it's unbiblical. It's unfounded. There is no thing as a resurrection because whose wife would she be? You can't answer the question. Therefore, the resurrection is erroneous. Well, they were refuting the resurrection by illustrating how biblical teaching seemingly proved the resurrection to be a harebrained idea, to be a harebrained doctrine. Now, it's obvious that the Sadducees probably used this in multiple settings. You know, like, this was their ace in the hole. They would bring it out to the Pharisees, they'd bring it out to the scribes, and all these different religious settings, because they would show their theological dominance, their supremacy over other groups. And they bring it to Jesus, and it's their Hollywood Hulk Hogan leg drop on Jesus. And that leads to Jesus giving an answer. He brings an answer that has two parts. Look at verse 29. In verse 29, he says this. It says, Jesus answered them, "You are wrong. Because, part one, you know neither the scriptures nor, part two, the power of God." Okay, so C.S. Lewis once said, nonsense is still nonsense, even if we speak it about God. Right? Nonsense is still nonsense, even if we speak it about God. I think that's very applicable to the Sadducees here. Or you could even say, speak it toward God. And that's why Jesus said, you're wrong. You're wrong because you don't know the power of, you don't know the scriptures, and you don't know the power of God. Let's think about the fact that they didn't know the scriptures. If you have read your New Testament, you know the New Testament teaches the doctrine of the resurrection. Like, a resurrection, a bodily resurrection is coming. Even the Old Testament taught this. Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. In the prophecy book of Daniel, at the end of it, it says this, "And many of those who sleep," it's a euphemism for they're dead, "who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake," another euphemism for resurrection, "some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt." The Old Testament taught the principle of resurrection, that it was going to happen. But remember, the Sadducees, well, they only believed the first five books of the Bible. And they believed that the resurrection was not taught by Moses. It was not in the first five books. And Jesus says, you're wrong. You don't know the scriptures as well as you think you do. Now, isn't it interesting? Something that happens in our heart often is, when we get a lot of Bible knowledge, sometimes when that begins to disconnect from our heart, what normally happens? What? Self-righteousness, pride. When we get a lot of Bible knowledge, like the Sadducees, and it begins to disconnect from our heart, Bible knowledge disconnected from our heart, we begin to grow in pride, self-righteousness. I want you to think about your life. Have you ever felt like you're the king of the hill of your circle because you know a lot of stuff about the Bible? Like, you can talk the ins and outs of theology, the ins and outs of different essential beliefs or different essential practices. Maybe you have a friend group that you look at your friend group and you think, man, I'm the most biblically literate person in this group. I'm the most mature, and the rest of these are immature. Like, be careful. Remember what Paul said? Paul said that knowledge, what? Puffs up. Knowledge has the ability to cause pride in our life, to grow pride. And then he followed that by saying, but love builds up, right? Knowledge that's connected to our heart builds up. Now, if you're thinking in your heart right now, you're thinking, that's right, Josh. you get those Bible thumpers. All those people who know the Bible, every day they read the Bible, they think they're so smart because they've been studying the Word of God and they know more than I know. Get them, Josh. Be careful. Don't misunderstand me. Like, I want our church to be rich in biblical knowledge. Like, I want you, to be able to tell the overarching story of the Bible to your one. And then help your one understand how they fit into that story, where their role is in that story. I want you to understand the essential doctrines of our faith. I want you to understand how you personally can grow in your faith. What are the tools that you need? My hope is you understand how the gospel relates teenagers to your dating, adults to your marriage. I hope you understand how the gospel impacts your job, your schooling, your sports, your parenting. Like, the church today may be more biblically illiterate than at any other time in the history of the church. In a season where we have more tools than any other generation has ever had. I mean, look, Justin Bieber and Ellen DeGeneres can read the Gospels to you. I mean, if you have an iPhone, I don't have mine on me, and you have YouVersion or the ESV Bible app or whatever Bible app you have a Bible in your pocket at all times. Like, that is new to our generation. This is a new thing. We have more tools than we have ever had, and we may be more biblically illiterate than any other generation of the people of God. So don't get me wrong, right? I'm not saying we don't need Bible knowledge. What I'm saying is be careful, because sometimes Bible knowledge, when it's disconnected to our heart, well, it can turn into pride. So I made a sophisticated slide to help us remember this. No Bible knowledge is bad. Bible knowledge disconnected from our heart is bad. Really sophisticated. Now, I want you to imagine for a second. Imagine you came up to me and you said, Josh, do you love your wife? Yeah. Tell me about her. And I said, okay. I love my wife. She has a passion for Star Wars, passion for Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings. I love how when she gets embarrassed, she gets the hiccups and she can't stop hiccuping over and over and over. I love that she can bench press 250 pounds. She dabbles in calligraphy and birdbath sculpting. And one of the most endearing things about my wife is that she loves my seasonal mustache. Like, if I told you that and you knew my wife, you would think, you don't know your wife. Like, you have no idea who your wife is. How can you say that you love her? You don't even know her. You love some imaginary person. Now imagine, though, if the Father Almighty walked in and asked you, do you love my son? Tell me about it. And after you finished your spiel or your prayer to the Father, would he respond in a similar way? You don't know my son because you don't know the scriptures. Because the scriptures, well, they tell you who my son is, right? And because you don't know him, you don't love him. You love some made-up being. You love someone who's not real. See, our aim as Christians is knowledge that pierces the heart, right? Doctrine that delights our soul. A cool biblical logic that is connected with white-hot passion for Christ. We want both, not one or the other, but both. And so the Sadducees, they didn't know the scriptures like they thought they did. And look at how Jesus teaches them the scriptures. Look at verses 31 and 32. We'll come back to 30 in just a second. It says, you're wrong, right? Because you don't know the scriptures. Verse 31. As for the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what was said to you by God? I'm the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. So Jesus, he pushes all the chips on the table. He says, very well, Sadducees, like you believe in the first five books of Moses, so let's go there. Your Bible guys, you believe they're from heaven. Do you remember that story in Exodus chapter 3? That there was this burning bush that burned, but it wasn't consumed. And in Exodus 3, verse 6, remember, God spoke from that bush. He said, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. Do you remember that? It's interesting because when God said that, he didn't say, I was the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, those men. But he said, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. See, think about it, church. By the time we get to Exodus chapter 3, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob have been dead for centuries. Centuries they have been dead. And so what Jesus is teaching the Sadducees is that centuries later, he is still in a covenantal relationship with those three men. Meaning, those three men aren't dead, but those three men are alive. That they've been not quite resurrected, but they are alive. He is the God of the living. He points to Exodus 3, and the verb, the present tense verb, I am, to point out the truth of the resurrection. And he says, therefore, God is the God of the living, not the dead. Because you deny the reality of the resurrection, you're wrong. And you prove that you don't know the scriptures. Because I'm not the God of the dead, I'm the God of the living. So they didn't understand the scriptures. But then he says, you're also wrong because you don't know the power of God. The power of God. Now, this is where we get the scriptural gut punch. Okay, this is where it may knock the wind out of us for just a moment. So journey with me for a second. Look back at verse 29. Jesus said, look, the resurrection is real. You're wrong. You don't know the scriptures, nor the power of God. Verse 30. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but they're like angels in heaven. Okay, so look at me. This passage teaches that in eternity, after the resurrection, there will be no more marriage, and that implies no more sexual relationships. Your marriage is momentary. It's of this age and will end in the next age. Anybody? Ouch. Anybody? Now, if you're giddy about that, like JT's like me, 11-year-old, it's hurting me. I'm hurting my heart. If you're giddy about that, that marriage ends in the age to come, like you probably need to see a counselor. You got some busted pops, right? In your marriage, they need fixing, okay? See, the Sadducees scenario about the woman with the seven legit husbands is now a non-issue. Because what Jesus says is, well, you don't understand my power. You don't understand the power of God. See, in their small-mindedness, they thought, if there is a next life, which there's not, that's what they said, then it has to be exactly like it is in this life. The playbook has to look exactly the same. It has to have perfect continuity. And especially in marriage. That's what they thought. But see, they were mistaken because they were trying to use some Bible knowledge to box God up. Right, let me give you this crazy scenario of seven husbands who were legit in their marriage to this woman. Whose will they be in the resurrection? And they took that and they boxed God up with it. Say, God, you can't have a resurrection. I'm boxing you up. I'm limiting your power. I'm going to slide it over. There you go. But we know as Christians, you can't box God up. His power isn't limited. He is limitless in his power. We got to be careful with that, though, don't we? Because isn't that what our culture says all the time? I don't know if you've ever heard this before, but you'll say something that's biblical truth, and someone will say, yeah, but you're boxing God up. And they'll point to the scriptures and say, the scriptures, man, it just boxes God up. Well, the problem with that is the scriptures aren't meant to box God. They're meant to reveal God, to show us who he is and how he works. And so be aware that the Sadducees were in fact trying to box God up, to limit his power, to say you can't do what you think you can do. And our culture looks at God sometimes, looks at us sometimes and says, you're boxing God up by saying there's an eternity in hell coming. You're boxing God up by saying that truth is absolute. You're boxing Jesus up if you say that he teaches anything but love and flowers and hugs and kisses, right? You're boxing him up. That's not the truth. The truth is the scriptures give us a picture that God works within his character and within his attributes. So think about it. God can't lie. Like God doesn't tempt anyone. God won't sin. That doesn't box God up. It teaches us what God is like. It exposes the truth of his character. Now, the Sadducees, they misunderstand the power of God. And their misunderstanding was about how they perceived life would have to be if there was an afterlife. How levirate marriage proved everything wrong. That the afterlife was absurd. See, what they didn't realize was their limited mind couldn't understand what was coming. That the God of the Bible was going to create new possibilities in such a way that would go beyond kind of to the fringes of our imagination. Well, what does that look like and what does that mean? That we will be like the angels. So last week we talked about this. We talked about the resurrected bodies. Remember that? We talked about the fact that we're going to get resurrected bodies much like our own, but new and better. Right, you're going to get a resurrected body much like your own, but much, much better. And that you'll be able to recognize people on the new earth. On the new earth in heaven, you'll breathe and you'll eat food and you'll sing songs and you'll work and you'll talk and you will be human. There will be great similarity between this earth as we know it and the new earth in heaven. Right, there will be great similarity, but there is a huge break in that, and that is in regards to marriage and sexual intimacy in marriage. On the next earth, we will not be married to our spouses, right? And that logically implies that there will not be any sexual intimacy in marriage either. So, the Bible says we have a model for this type of being. Look back at the text. Look at verse 30. Verse 30, it says, in the resurrection, Jesus says, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. So there is a being that's a model for us for what it is going to be like, and that's the angels. The angels enjoy heaven with God, but they don't marry, and they don't have marital intimacy, and they don't participate in those things. Now, I want you to understand. There's this thought in the church that when you die, you become an angel. You get wings and all that kind of stuff. That is not what this text teaches. That is not the truth. You do not become an angel when you die. You are categorically different. You are made in the image of God, and you will be an immortal human on the new earth. You're not going to be an angel. But in regards to marriage and in regards to marital intimacy, you will be like an angel. You won't be an angel, but you will be like that in heaven on the new earth. That's what this text teaches. So, show of hands. Little bit of a letdown? Anybody? Little bit of a letdown? All right. So five people are honest in here. All right, thanks for being honest with me, you five. If you're at home, please raise your hand. Now, if you're with your spouse at home, please raise your hand. Okay, so let me guess at a response to why this is a letdown. I think probably all of us agree that's a little bit of a letdown. Like, what's up, Jesus? I think it's a letdown because here's what we normally do when we think about heaven on the new earth. Now, I say that like that over and over because I'm trying to teach you that in heaven, we will be on a new earth, we'll be physical and such, okay? So, the reason I think we feel that way is because we normally think about heaven in light of the worst of this world, right? Like, you think about your life and you think about broken relationships in your family, and you have a hope one day that if they're in Christ, you're in Christ, those things will be reconciled, Like one day I won't be estranged from mom, or one day I won't be estranged from sister. There's a hope coming of this bad being put together on the new earth. Or you think about insecurities. Some people struggle so hard with insecurities. On the new earth, those things will be gone. Mental health issues will be gone on the new earth. Sickness, disease, sin, the struggle of sin, the fight against sin, how hard it is every day to wake up and put on Ephesians 6, put on your armor and go back in the fight. One day we will be at peace. One day we can lay those weapons down because the word of Christ is powerful, and we will live in intimacy with God on the new earth in peace. That's coming. And so I think one of the reasons we read this and we're kind of like, really, Jesus? Like, you got to get rid of marriage? Is because it's not the worst in comparison to the best. In fact, marriage, for most people, is considered the highest good, or one of the highest goods. And then marital intimacy, physical intimacy in marriage, a high, high good. And it's maybe one of the best things our world has to offer. And then we compare it to the next life and we go, Jesus has taken that away. Like, we compare one of the best to something that won't be there anymore. And I think that's why we feel the letdown. I honestly do. I think that's why we feel that way. So why does it have to be this way? Like, why this way? Like, why couldn't we stay married in heaven? Well, let me make 2 points. First point is this, and you see it on your screen. On the new earth, there is no marriage because there's no need of procreation. There's no need of procreation. So let's go look at the parallel account in Luke 20, verses 34 through 36. This is the other account. There's 3 accounts of this happening, and this is Luke's version. He says this, Jesus said to them, the sons of this age marry and are given in marriage, but those who are considered worthy to attain to that age and to the resurrection from the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. And here's why. For they cannot die anymore, because they are equal to the angels and are sons of God, being sons of the resurrection. So Jesus, he says, look, you're not going to be married. You're not going to be given in marriage on the new earth in heaven because, well, you're not going to die. And I think that implies this. Because you're going to live forever, there's no need to populate the world. Because you're going to continue in everlasting life on the new earth, there's no need for new babies. In fact, well, heaven's full, right? Heaven's complete. The basic, a basic and fundamental purpose of marriage is what? To have babies. To have babies, to fill the earth. That's why God planned it that way. Well, that comes to an end on the new earth because it's no longer necessary. We don't need to have babies on the new earth. Heaven's full. So that makes sense. Not super comforting, right? Logically, I'm like, okay, I'm going with you there. I'm following you, Josh. Not super comforting. But maybe this will be of more comfort. Second point, second reason I want to make is this. Why does marriage end in heaven? I believe because pleasures, number 2, rise in eternity. Pleasures increase, they rise in eternity. So this past Wednesday, we had our children, one of the children leaders brought chalk, and you may have seen this when you walked in today, we had children writing their scripture verses out on the sidewalk, and so I decided to write my favorite verse, and it's Psalm 16:11. And it says, you make known to me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. That's what's coming in the presence of God. Full joy, full pleasures. Marriage is a great joy. It really is. When it aligns with our Creator's intention. When our marriage aligns with His intention laid out in Scripture, it is an incredible joy. A physical intimacy that we enjoy in marriage that's vulnerable, but protected by the covenant we make before each other and before God is sweet. It brings glory to God. It's a high pleasure and an incredible joy. But the best of marriages, listen closely, the best of marriages and the sweetest of physical intimacy in marriage in this world can be seen like Emma Kate's love of ice cream. This week I talked to Emma Kate and I was like, hey, what's your favorite thing? Like, what's your greatest joy? What's your what's the best pleasure? And she said, ice cream. To a six-year-old, nothing tops an ice cream cone. Cookie two-step, right? Nothing tops it. And I'm like, that's precious, honey. That's really sweet. But as adults, though we may like ice cream, in light of the pleasure of marital intimacy, you keep the cone, right? You keep the cone. Like, there's a distance between those two pleasures, isn't there? Like, ice cream's good, marriage and intimacy in marriage better, right? There's a distance here. Hopefully you're following. Okay, and there's a lot. And so it is in the resurrection. In the resurrection, there's pleasures there, there's joys there, there's fullness of joys that we can't quite grasp how good they are, right? But there's a distance between that and marriage and intimacy in marriage. See, right now, Emma Kate, she knows in part. Kind of like she's looking through the stained glass. She can see through the stained glass that ice cream is joyous, that it brings great pleasure, that the senses of her tongue go crazy because they're delicious. But one day, she will know more fully. She'll know the joy of marriage. This is a season where she thinks and acts like a child. But one day, she's going to grow up. And when she grows up, she's going to realize ice cream, as good as it is, isn't better than marriage. She will give up her childish ways. And so too for us in eternity. Like, marriage is sweet. For those of you who are married, it's a sweet pleasure. It's a great joy, especially as you live it according to what Christ has done and taught us in the Word. But it's just a signpost of what's coming. When you drive into Texas, in many locations, you'll see that big cutout in stone of the Texas sign, right? And that's kind of what marriage is in light of eternity. When you drive into Texas and you see that awesome Texas sign, you want to get out and take a picture in front of it because you're like, I'm in Texas. But that's not Texas. Like, the sun sets out in West Texas. That's Texas. The deep ravines of Paladura, that's Texas. The history of the Alamo, right? The woodlands of East Texas, that's Texas. The sign, it's good. You're going to take a picture in front of it. You're going to enjoy it for a minute. But it's just a sign. It's just telling us of the good that's to come. It's an appetizer for what's coming, right? Pleasures rise in eternity. I think all earthly pleasures that translate from here to there only get better, which is another reason why I think having babies ends here. I mean, go back to the hospital. The day you had your child, if you have a child, go back to the hospital, Trent. Go back just a couple of days. And think about the joy that came that day when you first heard the sound of your baby, that first cry. I don't know. I'm not sure how you can eclipse that joy. Maybe that's another reason why there is no having babies in heaven, because God gave us the eclipse of that here. We get the best taste of that here, right? Just a side note. In heaven, on the new earth, look, you're going to know your spouse. All right, Nancy, you'll know Jerry, right? Brittany, you'll know Brian. Joe, you'll know Mama. Like, we will know each other. But it's going to be better and different. Better than we can imagine, but it will be different. The world to come is not just an improvement over the worst in this life. It truly is an improvement over the best. Like, it is better than the best we have here. And that means when we think about this truth that marriage ends, I know as Christians we can look at that and go, but I love my marriage. Like, Katie and I are about to go to Arkansas and celebrate 10 years. Like, I love our marriage. I love my life. Like, I don't want that to, you know, I'm praying for my family who's going to have to watch my kids for a week. But, like, I mean, I'm excited to get out of here, right, and go spend a week with her. I love marriage. But we shouldn't look at this and go, I guess I'll just deal with it. I guess Jesus teaches it, so I'm just going to have to get on board. I think rather we should have some sort of anticipation that something better's coming. Like, we're all kids, aren't we? Licking ice cream cones, thinking, it can't get better than this. But the father's looking down going, if he only knew what I had in store. Because pleasures will rise in eternity. See, Jesus, he looks at the Sadducees and he says, you're wrong about the resurrection. You're wrong because you don't know the scriptures, and you're wrong because you don't know the power of God. Now look how this passage ends. Look at verse 33. It says this, and when the crowd heard it, that's Jesus refuting the Sadducees, defending the resurrection. It says, when the crowd heard it, they were astonished at his teaching. The crowd was astonished. They were blown away. And the next verse, you find out that the Sadducees were silenced, according to verse 34. See, Jesus, doesn't he have a way of wowing and woeing? Like, Jesus, doesn't he have this way of opening people up to his greatness and his glory, his majesty and his wisdom? I'm thinking about your own heart. When you listen to the teachings of Jesus, when you sing songs of Jesus, doesn't he just open your heart up to him? Isn't it like, this is amazing, more. Like, this is awesome, give me more. I want more servings. I want more helpings. He has a way of doing that. But he also has a way of entrenching us. His words have a way of entrenching those who would deny him. So don't fall victim to the same temptation of the Sadducees. Lots of Bible knowledge weaponized against the Messiah. Bible knowledge that actually kept them from intimacy with the one who came to save them. Right? The book didn't draw them to the Messiah. It puffed them up in knowledge, and pride entrenched them. They used this to get what they wanted, not who they needed. Right? They got what they wanted. They wanted power, but they didn't get who they needed. They needed God. They needed to hear his voice and worship him in submission. So I hope, as we think about this passage, I hope this. I hope that God's Spirit would connect these truths to our heart, and that they would move us to worship him because he's worthy of worship. I hope that we would be a people who know the scriptures in our minds and connect the scriptures to our heart. That we would pray that God's Spirit would do that work in us so that we could be like Christ and live like him in this world. And I hope we're the type of people that we would remember that even the hard truths, truths that on the nose of it kind of make us go, ugh, like marriage ending, we wouldn't feel that way. But we would remember that all the truths that Christ came to teach, all the truths revealed in Scripture, are not only to God's glory, but good for his people. Good for you. Good for me. So my question for you is this. Do you believe that? Do you believe it? Do you trust the Scriptures? And in trusting the Scriptures, do you trust the Savior? Let's pray. Father, this morning, we've tackled a tough truth in your word. A truth that you have used to defend the resurrection, that one day we will be with you in eternity in physical bodies. Different but good. God, I pray that you would begin to make that a sweet truth to us. God, I pray that we would be the type of church that is open to hard truths. God, that we would be open to listen to your word, lean into your word, and obey in joy. Father, an eternity is coming for us. For those who know your son Jesus and love him, that eternity is going to be sweet. Pleasures will rise in eternity. We're little children licking ice cream cones, and we don't know the great joy that's coming. God, but for others, there's an eternity coming. For those who don't know Jesus, there's an eternity coming that's going to be filled with suffering and sorrow, regret, and anger, and pain, separated from you in eternity in hell. And so I pray that this morning we would see your son, be astonished at his truths, at who he is, and respond in faith. Let us not be the Sadducees, anchoring down in our unbelief. We love you. As we respond, work in us, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.